Good morning, everyone. We'll talk right before lunch, so I'll try and be speedy. So I'm going to be speaking on management of the precursor conditions, MGUS and smoldering myeloma, and the prevention of progression. So one, to just start off, what are the differences or what is the definition of these plasma cell precursor conditions, MGUS or monoclonal gammopathy of undetermined significance, smoldering myeloma versus active myeloma? So the key point for these two, we consider precursor conditions, is the absence of a myeloma defining event, typically the presence of bone lesions, lowered blood counts, high calcium, kidney dysfunction. You know, when we look at the bone marrow, that differentiates the MGUS condition from myeloma with the presence of less than 10% plasma cells. Whereas when we go to smoldering myeloma, there is greater than 10% or less than 60%. A little correction here, the active myeloma is defined by the presence of greater than 10% plasma cells, as well as a clinically defining event for organ damage. It speaks to the heterogeneity of this disease, and that you can have active myeloma with just 10% plasma cells in the bone marrow, but then bone lesions throughout, versus you can have asymptomatic myeloma or smoldering myeloma with 60% plasma cells, but the absence of all those symptoms. So these precursor conditions, MGUS and smoldering, do exist on a spectrum, with MGUS on one end and smoldering myeloma on the other. And we typically see here that the risk of progression for MGUS, which we consider a benign precancerous condition, is roughly about 1% per year. Chance of change from anywhere between a change to a smoldering myeloma, AL amyloidosis, as Dr. Bianchi spoke about, or active myeloma. Subsequently, in the condition of, this should read, low risk smoldering myeloma or high risk smoldering myeloma, is the notably, you can understand that when the percent of plasma cells increases in the bone marrow, the percent chance of risk of progression does increase, and it's noted to be a little bit higher of 10% per year chance of change to active myeloma. However, this is not fully representative of this diverse population, as in individuals with higher risk smoldering myeloma may have up to a 40 to 50% risk of progression within the first 2 years of diagnosis. A little bit more on the heterogeneity of progression in smoldering myeloma and MGUS. This was a study by Dr. Kyle in Mayo Clinic that looked at the kinetics of progression amongst patients with these precursor conditions. 10% per year is a little bit of, doesn't highlight the nuance of the disease. We see that within the first 5 years of patients after diagnosis of smoldering myeloma, the risk does appear to be 10% per year. However, subsequently, out of those patients with smoldering myeloma that do not progress, the risk does appear to drop to 3% per year in the next 5 years, and subsequently 1% per year in subsequent 5 years. Whereas in MGUS, the risk of progression does seem to be, the slope seems to be pretty constant at roughly 1% per year. But at the same time, not every patient with smoldering myeloma may have a 10% chance per year of risk of progression. We utilize stratification tools to better personalize and individualize risk. One easy and common tool we use is the Mayo Clinic 20-20 model. It's very digestible and readily available for us to use. It utilizes bone marrow plasma cell information, serum markers of the monoclonal protein, as well as your serum free light chain ratio. That's where the 20-20 comes from. These are the thresholds. The presence of none of these risk factors places you in the low risk group. Two or more risk factors place you in the high risk group. And from there, we can separate out different groups, and we see that there's different risk profiles. The low risk group, the risk of progression within the first 2 years seems to be less than 6 or 7%. And then subsequently amongst the higher risk group, the chance of progression within the first 2 years can be as high as roughly 45 to 50%. However, how can we do better on this? Our goals are always to, we don't have that crystal ball, but we should work towards improving our prediction accuracy, being able to have a more personalized risk stratification for our patients. And thoughts of doing this started this research project or initiative by Dr. Irene Gobriel's lab called the Pangea model, where they aim to improve prediction accuracy by including time varying measurements, considering new novel biomarkers, thinking about ways to stratify risk without requiring that bone marrow biopsy, as well as utilizing, creating a risk model that may be applicable for individuals with both MGUS as well as smoldering myeloma. And with that led to the development of the Pangea calculator that's also available online. They published, Dr. Gobriel and with Annie Cohen published the Pangea model in 2023. One interesting, outcome, the really demonstrating the sophistication about this model, showed that, in the Pangea model, they saw that 58% of, up to 58% of patients who were previously categorized as either intermediate or low risk based on the, historical 2220 model, who then go on to progress to active myeloma, were actually a little bit better characterized as high risk amongst the Pangea model. You can kind of see the change in patients in these categories in the 2220 into the newer model. It seems to have a little bit better accuracy. I wanted to shift next to how do we know who will get a precursor condition? So there are two large screening studies that I wanted to talk about that kind of help us understand the prevalence, understand the characteristics of people who have this precursor condition. One is called the iSTOP-MM study. This comes out of Iceland, in which they aim to screen any individual over the age of 40, which is probably very unique to the country of Iceland and no other place in the world. And another to really screen for and detect who in the country may have a monoclonal protein or a plasma cell disorder. And the second is the PROMISE study that is led by Dr. Irene Gobriel here at Dana-Farber that seeks to screen individuals who have a risk factor, either by having being of African-American descent or having a first degree relative with a plasma cell disorder, or has two first degree relatives with a hematologic malignancy over the age of 30. And so some interesting results have come out of these studies. The iSTOP-MM study has led to several different publications and new insights. One of them, especially, they were one of the first to establish the prevalence of smoldering myeloma in individuals over the age of 40, seeing roughly a half of a percent prevalence. And roughly one third of these individuals with smoldering myeloma were seen to be intermediate risk or high risk. Additionally, amongst the patients who screened positive for the MGUS condition, they found the prevalence to be roughly 3.9 or close to 4% in individuals over the age of 40 and 5% in individuals over the age of 50. Roughly the same or a little bit higher than the prior prevalence estimates coming out of Mayo Clinic. From the PROMISE study, that's found that the prevalence or the frequency of MGUS amongst individuals who have a risk factor does appear to be higher. Roughly 13 to 17% of these individuals screen positive for a monoclonal gammopathy. Utilizing additionally very advanced technologies such as mass spectrometry, we can also have higher rates of detection of very subtle monoclonal proteins or abnormal free light chains. The work is ongoing, but it does suggest that, especially in older individuals who do have one of these predisposing factors, either African-American descent or a family member with a history of a plasma cell disorder or a blood cancer may benefit from screening in order for early detection of these plasma cell disorders. Next, how do we manage precursor conditions? I spent a lot of time talking about how we risk stratify, what is the frequency, because that does become a big component of how we frame treatment or management. So currently, the standard of care for individuals with MGUS and smoldering is observation, especially because the risk of progression is very low in individuals with MGUS, as well as low-risk smoldering myeloma, because these individuals will go many, many years or may never go on to progress to active myeloma. So why treat someone who will never develop a problem? However, there is, you know, the subgroup, as we've identified, with high-risk smoldering myeloma patients who have a very high risk of going on to develop active disease. And when you know that, you know, the when our standard is just to wait, it becomes, you know, quite a big dilemma. And thus, clinical trial participation, as well as the trials that have been already performed, have been really helpful in trying to, you know, answer the question, what is the right treatment, who are the right people to treat, and when do we treat? So one of the first early studies looking at early intervention for smoldering myeloma in patients came out of Spain. This was a study that was a phase 3 randomized trial comparing the usage of Revlimid or lenalidomide and dexamethasone compared to observation in high-risk smoldering myeloma patients. This was started in 2007, and what it showed was that the usage of Revlimid early did seem to improve the time or delay the time of onset for myeloma, as well as improve overall survival amongst individuals with high-risk smoldering myeloma compared to those who were just on observation. Additionally, a similar study was performed in the United States through the ECOG cooperative groups, looking at Revlimid treatment versus, again, no treatment in all smoldering myeloma in patients. Similarly, it showed that there appeared to be an improvement in progression-free survival or delaying the time or the onset of active myeloma in those getting treated with Revlimid compared to those who were on observation. These charts, we split up the patients based upon their risk categorization, and it appears that those individuals with high-risk smoldering myelomas seem to have the most pronounced benefit with early intervention with Revlimid compared to those who are intermediate risk or low risk, as you can see that the kind of the progression-free survival curves seem to overlap. This study thus far hasn't demonstrated a difference or an improvement in overall survival compared to the Spanish study, maybe reassuringly that not as many patients have passed. Additionally, you know, with the advent of more novel agents, the monoclonal antibody daratumumab has also been studied in the context of smoldering myeloma amongst intermediate and high-risk smoldering myeloma patients of varying durations in the Centaurus study, looking at short duration and a longer duration, asking the question if applying this new immune therapy may deepen response as well as delay or prevent progression. What it showed was that, you know, there was a response, maybe not too robust at overall 30 to 50, 60%, but it did seem to extend or did show a progression-free survival of anywhere about 74 or longer months, which is longer compared to historical controls. However, there was no comparator arm in this study. And then more recently, we've been asking the question, can we bring combinational therapies often used in the treatment of active myeloma, either in the newly diagnosed or relapse refractory setting, earlier into these high-risk smoldering myeloma patient population? This is not an exhaustive list, but a few trials that have been recently performed, two in the US, the NCI study and the ASCENT study, looking at the combination of carfilzomib, lenalidomide, dexamethasone, KRD, or with the four-drug regimen with the addition of daratumumab, as well as this Spanish study, the GEM-CESAR study, looking at dara KRD plus transplant, all regimens that we have seen used in newly diagnosed myeloma patients. And it has shown that there's been robust, deep responses, you know, anywhere between 70 to 84% of patients achieving MRD negativity that we've heard earlier has now been achieving approval for as an endpoint for our trials, as well as progression-free survivals, very high rates, however, in the 80 to 94%. But all of these trials, their follow-up is still relatively short in the 3 to 5 year range. So we need more time to understand the outcomes. And also thinking about the intensity of treatments is very critical when thinking about this patient population. Here at Dana-Farber, there's an ongoing phase two trial studying the combination of daratumumab, bortezomib, lenalidomide, and dexamethasone in high-risk patients. This is a regimen that we've really come to use quite often in newly diagnosed in active myeloma patients. This is called the B-PRISM study. Again, asking the question of using this very active quadruplet in high-risk smoldering myeloma patients, that whether or not treatment for about 24 months or 2 years, a limited duration, can lead to, again, high rates of MRD negativity, and then also see what outcomes are. Subsequently, this trial has two parts. The first part is treatment for 2 years, assess the MRD response rate, and amongst patients who do not achieve MRD negative responses, we then ask the question, if we randomize between two-drug daratumumab and Revlimid versus observation, what are then the outcomes? Thus far, in the 18 months of follow-up for enrolled patients, there is a 100% response rate with no evidence of progression, as well as achievement of high MRD negativity rates. That does seem to increase or deepen over time. And then, as you know, Dr. Sperling had spoken about and in earlier mentions, immune therapies is coming into the field, especially showing impressive responses for relapsed refractory myeloma patients. But can we leverage this in smoldering myeloma as well? This is a time when individuals' immune systems are likely more less deranged or abnormal than at the very refractory stages of relapsed refractory myeloma. The tumor burden is theorized to be smaller, and you know, this may give us opportunities to avoid certain side effects that are, you know, commonly seen with our conventional therapies. So opening up a new potential door for investigation. And so one of these studies investigating the usage of immune therapy is called ImmunoPrism, that's currently underway here at Dana-Farber. It evaluates the usage of bispecific antibodies in high-risk smoldering myeloma patients. ImmunoPrism is a phase two randomized study comparing the standard of care, which is Revlimid dexamethasone, comparing to the bispecific antibody right now with teclistamab or Tecalvi, again, which is a antibody that one recognizes something specific to the cancer, BCMA, and the other engaging a aspect of our immune system, the T cell. By bringing the T cell close to the tumor cell, it then activates the T cell and then induces tumor killing. The dosing schedule of the trial for the bispecific antibodies listed here compared to the dosing regimen in active myeloma, relapsed myeloma, this is a little bit more spaced out. And additionally, it is a limited duration of time of up to 2 years. And Dr. Anderson showed this slide as well, but this trial is underway, but out of the patients treated, they've shown an impressive response. All have responded, 100% response rate, and also 100% MRD negativity rate of MRD negative to 10 to the negative 6, with achievement within just merely 4 months. So just in summary and in conclusion, you know, precursor conditions, MGUS and smoldering are characterized by the presence of an abnormal plasma cell, but there is no organ damage. MGUS is quite a common condition. The prevalence does increase with age. And there's variable or a mixed risk of progression between these conditions. Clinical risk models associated with progression do help us, but we have areas to improve. You know, we have openings to incorporate more sophisticated molecular markers as well. Screening efforts are underway, and they really help us understand who is at risk for developing these conditions and who may go on to then progress. Single arm studies with intervention do seem to show advantage with early intervention, especially amongst the high-risk smoldering individuals. And individuals with high-risk smoldering myeloma thus should be offered and discussed about participation for clinical trials, and as well as all individuals with precursor conditions may have the opportunity to participate in observational and or interventional trials to better understand, you know, who's at risk of progression, who may benefit from treatment, and what that optimal treatment regimen is.